This is Dr. Ben Weitz with the Rational Wellness Podcast, bringing you the cutting-edge information on health and nutrition from the latest scientific research and by interviewing the top experts in the field. Please subscribe to the Rational Wellness Podcast on iTunes and YouTube and sign up for my free ebook on my website by going to drweitz.com. Let's get started on your road to better health.
Hey, Rational Wellness Podcasters, thank you so much for joining me again today. For those of you who enjoyed this podcast, please go to iTunes and give us a ratings and review. So our Rational Wellness Podcast is focused on various functional medicine topics and how we can use natural methods to help prevent and reverse various types of chronic diseases. Many of our discussions have been about the gut and hormones and metabolic conditions, autoimmune diseases, detoxification. But this same model of health can be applied to every area of the body. We've recently had Dr. Cates on to talk about a functional medicine approach to the skin, and Dr. Ziegler talking about the health of the eyes. Now we're going to apply the functional medicine model to the health of the mouth and the teeth. And I'm very happy that we have Dr. Stephen Lin joining us today, who's a functional medicine dentist, speaker, author of the number one Amazon best-selling book, The Dental Diet. Dr. Lin focuses on the understanding of dental disease through nutritional principles. His work has highlighted that crooked teeth and orthodontia epidemic are diet-based problems and the need for public health policy to prevent braces in the next generation of children. Dr. Lin, thank you for joining me today.
Ben, such a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
So how did you get so interested in nutrition as a dentist?
Yeah, it's a funny story. I was actually practicing as a dentist years ago, and I was beginning to become a little bit disillusioned with my day's work. I was finding that there were very sick people in my practice with conditions that were very, very common. You know, dental disease is some of the most common we have in society today. And whether it was kids with tooth decay or with malformed jaws and that didn't fit their teeth, or whether it was adults with gum disease, where I was extracting, in some cases, teeth out of the 40 and 50-year-olds, their last teeth out of their jaws. And it began to play on me that I didn't really have the answers as to why this was happening. And so I actually took some time away from my practice, and I went traveling through Europe, and I was in a traveler's hostel in Istanbul, Turkey, and there was a shared reading shelf there where I saw a book called Nutrition and Physical Degeneration by Weston A. Price. Now, I'd never heard of the book before, and so I kind of picked it up, and I was like, you know, what is this? It had the words DDS on the title of the book, so it kind of got my attention, even though I was trying to escape dentistry at the time. but I opened it, and it was a world that I'd never seen before. You know, Price was a guy that went around the world and in the 30s and 20s and 30s and documented over 14 cultures around the world, and where the modern diet interfaces how people had been living ancestrally for thousands of years. And he showed that modern dental disease doesn't occur until we hit the Industrial Revolution, until we start eating modern diets. And this was happening right up until the 30s, when people were living with absolutely absent of dental disease. So that's no crooked teeth, no tooth decay, but also no wisdom teeth impactions. And you think about how rite of passage the wisdom teeth impactions are today. And this whole perspective has been lost. So it really kind of opened my mind to the idea that there was information from our ancestors that we've lost and that we've misinterpreted, and that our food today had a drastic impact on our mouth, and that really epigenetically and with modern science now, we can actually plug in the missing pictures that Price painted back in the 30s. And it's fascinating. That's what led me to write my book and try and help the dental profession move forward into this functional medicine perspective.
Can you explain how the shape of the jaw has changed due to the modern diet and how this affects our teeth?
Yeah, so probably the simplest way to put it is that the most common way that people see the orthodontist is that when you are a child of age around 10 to 12 to 13, your adult dentition has erupted and you go to the orthodontist to straighten those teeth. Sometimes they will extract teeth and sometimes they will just put braces on. The braces really only, they only straighten the dentition and they don't address why the impactions of, the malocclusion, which is crooked teeth, has occurred in the first place. And so a child at 12 that needs braces is experiencing the same problem as a late adolescent or a young adult that has their wisdom teeth out.
Once again, this is kind of like the functional model, which is what's the root cause rather than just treating the symptom.
Exactly. So that's exactly. So braces and wisdom teeth extractions are just treating a symptom. And the symptom is that our jaws aren't growing and that we don't have space now to fit 32 human teeth. And in my career, I've seen very few people that have jaws that develop to house their wisdom teeth and a full straight dentition. And so when you look anthropologically, this doesn't occur. And so what we now have is a very different areas of science have worked out why this happens. And so we haven't quite brought it together, which is why, for instance, the dental and orthodontic professions haven't really applied this, because we don't have a conjoined theory on this. But the idea is that if you don't send the signals for your jaw to grow, which include chewing, which include the nutrients that balance calcium in the body, which include breathing factors, so being able to breathe through the nose and using the tongue correctly, all of these are a functional model as to how the jaw grows during those formative years, between age 0 to 12 until you form the adult dentition, and continues to grow till you're 21, and then right throughout life as well. That's one thing, Ben, as well, is that we can actually expand the adult palate and change both the upper and lower jaw in an adult in a slightly lesser way than we can in children, but we can always change our jaw, and that every meal is really contributing to how our teeth are formed, and the teeth are just the symptom.
So that's fascinating. So essentially, I think what you're saying is that the modern refined carbohydrate diet with all this soft food that, we woof down without even chewing, we don't have the fibrous, the types of foods that really require, the vegetable matter, the foods that really require a lot of work for our jaws is part of the problem, right?
Yeah, exactly. So your jaws are a musculoskeletal joint, funnily enough, and that the anthropological studies show that once we move into civilizations, people in hunter-gatherer situations, they don't experience malocclusion as much as what we do in as soon as we hit civilization. That's when crooked teeth begin to occur. And so that's the idea that chewing is a nutrient is something that we don't have in dietary recommendations, do we? And we are a society that tends to blend and juice things as much as we can. And that's something that we really haven't done in our history to in terms of our nutrient intake. So I think that's a really important one, that chewing is a part. It starts at breastfeeding, which begins to grow the child's palate. And that's really where we learn how to use the oral cavity as a musculoskeletal entity of the body.
Interesting. Maybe we shouldn't even use forks and knives, just use our teeth more.
I mean, that's an interesting, I actually haven't but you probably bang on there that we're, the way we're kind of cutting things down, we're taking kind of that work away from the jaws. And, most anthropological kind of studies show people with very worn teeth, but and almost worn to the point where sometimes the enamel's gone. And that just shows over their life they've been chewing an enormous amount. And the amount of chewing we just don't probably go near anymore. So that's probably a good point, yeah.
So in your book, you talk about, when you were talking about the wisdom teeth, I think it's amazing that you were saying that we just take it for granted that we're removing these wisdom teeth, and you compare it to if we were cutting off fingers or toes, people would be outraged, and we don't even think twice about losing your wisdom teeth.
You would probably think twice if you had to cut off, for instance, if your hand didn't develop to fit your pinky finger, you know, and you had to have it cut off. That would seem weird, right? Well, we haven't asked the same question for some reason about our teeth, and that, you know, we just extract teeth without even the thought about it, and that it's normal. But it really does kind of point to one of the biggest epidemics on the planet, where that our jaws aren't developing when we're in these childhood years. And, you know, I see the effects of it every day. Yeah, children today are showing the effects of not developing, not breathing right, not eating right. And we can really intervene in this with a functional model.
What role does breathing through our nose versus breathing through our mouth play in this process?
Yeah, that was a big factor of discovery for myself, where to learn that really oxygen is the number one nutrient for our body. And you think of how long you can last without, water, for instance. Well, oxygen trumps water, where, you know, you can only last minutes without having to, keel over if you're not breathing properly. But we are a species now that doesn't breathe properly nearly all the time. And that is through the nose, with a closed mouth, with the tongue to the roof of the mouth. And what that does is it delivers oxygen in a much more efficient way. It delivers oxygen in a way where we center the head over the spine, which you would be very familiar with, Ben. But so what mouth breathing does, and so when we learn not to breathe through the nose, we breathe through the mouth, which is a survival response. And so mouth breathing really doesn't deliver the nutrient nitric oxide, which mixes with air in the nasal sinuses and helps the body to extract oxygen and increase blood flow to the lung areas in order to extract oxygen. When you breathe through your mouth, you don't get this. And so what also mouth breathing does is that it stunts the growth of the jaws. So kids that mouth breathe, so you'll see them with their mouth open, you know, when they're watching TV with their tongue hanging out of their mouth, they are by definition stunting the growth of their jaws. So they'll have a narrow palate, they'll have crooked teeth, and it's due to a functional issue. And so that factor in both the idea of how we feed ourselves and how we give ourselves the nutrients that our body needs. You take 20,000 breaths a day, you know, at a conservative estimation. So you really can't undervalue how important breathing is.
And how does improper breathing lead to snoring, sleep apnea, teeth grinding?
Yes. So what's really interesting is that our daytime postures, and this is really, you know, interconnected with your work, Ben, it affects...
Yeah, we do a lot of work with posture.
Right. And so, you know, how you hold your oral posture and your neck, and how you use your oral pharynx controls how your airway is operated during the day. And so when you go to sleep, all of those muscles relax and you only have the very deep and fundamental muscles really kind of keeping you, your airways open and you're breathing. So if we have a mouth open posture through the day, what will happen is that you'll have a mouth open posture at night. And so that contributes to the loss of airway space that then causes a vibration, which is snoring. But then this goes on into a sequence of pathology, which ends in obstructive sleep apnea. And that's where we're having pausing of up to 20 seconds at a time. But over a night, people can pause for minutes. And so you count for 20 seconds. It's quite frightening. And kids today are even being diagnosed with obstructive sleep apnea. And at the base of it is a breathing dysfunction. We're not breathing right through the day. And then through the night, we're then... we have this structure, both the jaws aren't developed, we're not using the muscles right, and we're not learning to breathe through the nose where we should.
Yeah, interesting. I've been learning how to breathe through the nose, taking coaching lessons with a breathing coach. And what do you think about taping the mouth at night? That's a way to try to train people to breathe through the nose. I've heard other practitioners talk about that.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. The taping is a way to kind of, because what happens is we do develop a habit of the lips coming open. So it does help us to kind of make sure that you're breathing through the nose. I'd recommend that people kind of acclimatize and do some training before they do something like that, because some people do find that they get a claustrophobic feel out of it, or they can kind of wake violently if they do, for instance, if they're not used to breathing through the nose. But I personally tape my mouth. I think it's, I've had to train myself as well, so it wasn't something that I could immediately do. And, you know, it really depends on your dental anatomy too. If you have a high palate, it's going to be hard. And, you know, you really should be doing some breathing myofunctional therapy to reprogram your tongue to be the roof of the mouth, to really kind of get your body used to being in that physiological posture.
Okay. In your excellent book, The Dental Diet, which I highly recommend to everybody, you talk about upper respiratory airway resistance syndrome, right? Upper airway resistance syndrome. And how this can relate to various types of digestive disorders and other health issues, including ADHD in kids. And is it really true that learning to play the Australian didgeridoo can help with this?
Yeah, well, it's really, well, one study showed that people with obstructive sleep apnea, they had beneficial results from playing the Australian didgeridoo, which is the long kind of wind. You use deep diaphragmatic muscles to kind of make that deep sound. It's really interesting. But What upper airway resistance syndrome is, or UARS, is it's on the spectrum of sleep apnea. And so people with obstructive sleep apnea are diagnosed via a polysomnograph. And so what with upper airway resistance syndrome, they found at Stanford in the 90s that there were a set of people that had a similar set of symptoms, but weren't being diagnosed for obstructive sleep apnea. So they didn't have the pauses in their breathing, and they were having polysomnographs, and the researchers were saying, well, these people don't have this sleep disorder. Well, what upper airway resistance syndrome is where you go to sleep, your airways contract because, one, we don't have the jaws to support the volume of airway we used to, and we don't also have the muscle function to support the breathing that we do either. And so what happens is these people go into a state of what they have are REARs, or respiratory effort arousal efforts. And what happens is that these REARs wake the brain up, but that not to the point where you wake up yourself, but they push the brain into a fight or flight mode. And so it's a feeling like you're choking. And what happens is that pushes you into sympathetic. And so the symptoms you have is that you're tired all the time. You don't feel like you get rest. Your digestive system isn't working because you're constantly pushed into sympathetic, where it should be into parasympathetic mode. Depression is very very common. Other issues like skin issues, but also teeth grinding. So one of the biggest signs is teeth grinding, where the jaw is coming forward to open the airway. So that's a response by the brain, due to the decreased volume in the airways, to push the jaw forward and open that airway. And so teeth grinding and UARS is a big sign, and you will not be diagnosed for obstructive sleep apnea. However, you do have a sleep issue, and the underlying problem is the jaw growth, but then from that breathing dysfunction and retraining that breathing is really important for these people.
Is it true that having cavities can be related to deficiencies of the fat-soluble vitamins A, D, and K2?
Yeah, so what we often don't hear is that we have an immune system inside our teeth. And so these little immune cells come from the bone marrow. And so these little stem cells from your bone marrow either become bone-making cells or immune cells, you know, in very simple terms. But they also become teeth cells that sit in your dental pulp, so in the inside of your teeth, and they guard your dentin. And this is like an immune reaction your teeth have. And so what they do is they respond if you have any kind of bacteria that creep down the dental enamel to try and infect the dentin. They can actually prevent that. And so they can cause an immune response. Now, these cells, like your skeletal system, they run on vitamin D, vitamin A, and vitamin K2. So people that have tooth decay, and this is what Weston A. Price found, he said every ancestral culture had levels of fat-soluble vitamins, you know, 10 to 20 times what we eat today. And if you don't think about how much of these nutrients you're eating, I guarantee you are deficient in them. And what that means is that we are susceptible to tooth decay. So tooth decay is a model of lack of nutrients, and it's also an imbalance in the bacteria that live in the mouth as well.
So essentially it's dysbiosis of the oral microbiome.
Yeah, so that's the other side of the picture. So we've got the teeth with an immune system inside, and then on the outside we've got these bacteria. And we've been scrubbing and killing bacteria for the last 50 years, but what we've missed is that we're actually killing the diversity of the oral microbiome. So there are trillions of bugs that live throughout the body, and the mouth is really the first and connected version of your interface with bacteria. And so bacteria in the mouth, you swallow thousands of bacteria every second. That's trillions every day. And so that's being communicated to your gut, which then forms your immune system. 80% of the immune system lies in the gut. And so the mouth really is one of the key players in shaping how your body lives and reacts with the bacteria. And tooth decay, we've known as a bacterial disease for a long time, but it's not an infection. It's a loss of probiotic bacteria, and same as gum disease as well. It's a underlying gut problem that has a lack of probiotic species in the mouth to balance those bacteria. And then what we have is the destruction of the gums and bone structures in the mouth.
So we've been killing the bacteria by using antibacterial mouthwash and antibacterial toothpaste, right?
So one study last year showed that alcoholic mouthwashes can increase the risk of pre-diabetes in a certain set of the population. So that shows that you destroy the diversity in the mouth and you increase your risk of problems in the gut later on. But anthropologically, you know, we've destroyed these bacteria by eating the wrong food. So underlying everything is diet. And so once we change the diet, we lose that diversity, and then the diseases come as a result.
You didn't mention it in your book, but what do you think about fluoride?
Yeah, I tried to stay away from fluoride because it's so controversial, but you know, fluoride, everything we've just talked about, the immune system inside teeth and the microbiome, we have the capabilities in our body to completely prevent and be absolutely resistant to tooth decay. Fluoride addresses a very small sliver of that equation. It's incorporated into the tooth enamel to make it more resistant to acid. Now, if you stop the acid release and you give your teeth the immune building factors, which are the fat-soluble vitamins, then you don't need fluoride. And so fluoride is applicable in certain treatment situations where we have severe decay, but it really doesn't address the root cause. And that's a big issue. And where the functional medicine, functional dentistry kind of interface needs to join together to have a good conversation about, because it's a big, big problem that links to everything throughout the body.
Yeah, what I see in America especially is that functional medicine practitioners like myself, who believe that fluoride is not good to be taken in, especially the type of fluoride that's being put in, which is industrial waste product. And yet dentists are still saying, yes, you need fluoride. Yes, you need fluoride. It's a good thing.
Yeah, it's a bit of a problem because, you know, it's one of the baseline preventative measures of what dentists are taught, you know, because of that mechanism of making enamel more resistant to acid. But it doesn't make sense in a functional medicine perspective, because we know so much more about the body now. We know so much more about the microbiome, and, you know, we've really moved past the idea that fluoride is our underlying way of preventing. It's a treatment. It should be seen as a treatment.
Yeah, and I think potentially harmful in terms of affecting thyroid and a bunch of other things in the body, potentially negatively, on top of the fact that the type of fluoride that's, say, being put into the water is not even a purified form of fluoride. It's industrial waste from fertilizer industry that's left over.
Yeah, the sources of fluoride, that doesn't get discussed much either. So, I mean, and that would obviously play effect, because, you know, most of the idea of fluoridation came from mountain ranges that had a high mineral content of fluoride. And so this idea that we insert it in a chemical way, you know, probably isn't as effective anyway.
Can we measure the microbiome in the mouth?
Yeah, so we're getting there. Interestingly enough, you know, the oral microbiome is one of the, you know, lesser studied parts of the microbiome, yet it's the most accessible. And I really think it's going to be the future of medicine, where we, you know, take a little saliva sample and, you know, you can see your risk for all types of gut intolerances, you know, autoimmune issues. It's right from the bacteria in your mouth, because we have a communicative relation to the gut microbiome from the mouth. And so you can also measure inflammation factors. You know, I really think that at the moment it's coming along, so we're beginning to sequence the oral microbiome, but I think it really is the future.
What do you think about toothpaste with probiotics in it?
Also a spot for the future. At this stage, you know, there's not many out there, but it's a good idea. You know, so prebiotics, probiotics, you know, even collagen is an idea that's popped up. I really find toothpaste and brushing, you know, that's kind of it's a very superficial way of looking after teeth. It's great. You know, everyone should, you know, have an oral hygiene regime, but eating is really the way that you provide your body those nutrients. So that's kind of, you know, but I think there are some natural toothpaste out there that are really kind of showing that we can get away from these supermarkets.
I mean, what should we use for toothpaste? I've heard recommendations that you should use baking soda and coconut oil.
Baking soda and coconut oil is a good mix. Yeah, it really is a personal preference thing. Some people really like that peppermint kind of hit, but yeah, it's one that the big factor is that you stay away from a daily antibacterial. You don't want to be killing bacteria daily. And there are, you know, natural substances really are much more gentle for the for the microbiome.
Now they have toothpaste with clays and also with charcoal. What do you think about those?
Charcoal's obviously is very absorbed. It's got a high absorption factor. It can be reasonably effective for whitening. I'll just be careful with it because it's quite abrasive. So I wouldn't be doing it every day. Maybe, you know, if you do it every, you know, once every 2 weeks, once every month, it's a great way to kind of clear, you know, that plaque debris and staining from the tooth enamel surface. But yeah, I wouldn't do it every day.
What do you think about oil pulling?
Oil pulling, you know, it was an ancient Ayurvedic practice. You know, it goes back many years. I think it's the introduction of fat into the oral microbiome. You know, the problems we have there is through simple carbohydrates. So I think that there can only be benefits from that. In terms of studies, we don't really know exactly, you know, if it has measurable clinical benefits. But I think what I tell my patients to eat more coconut oil. If you eat more coconut oil in your diet, you're going to be introducing your body to this.
Okay. Is plaque on our teeth a bad thing?
Plaque, the bacteria in your mouth actually need to live there too. So plaque itself isn't bad, but it can be if we have the wrong bacteria. So it builds up, you know, after, you know, 12 hours, you'll start to build plaque on your teeth. And so if you eat the right foods, you know, it's actually, you know, fine. But, you know, to prevent dysbiosis, removing that plaque will kind of help stop any kind of bad bacteria buildup.
You mentioned in the dental diet that if you chew your food carefully, your salivary glands add enzymes to your saliva, which decreases the pH of the mouth. In the natural, even functional medicine movement today, there's so much talk about trying to alkalinize your body by eating an alkaline diet, drinking alkaline water. I wonder if this is going too far, since both our mouth and our intestinal tracts actually do better with a slightly acidic environment.
Yeah, I tend to agree, Ben, actually. I'm not big on the whole alkalizing kind of, I think, you know, in certain situations people are, but I really think the body has its own pH kind of balance. So I find in situations like in SIBO and kind of reflux situations where we see a lot of tooth enamel worn off so they have a lot of dental erosion. The problem is they don't have enough acid in their stomach, right? So they need, they're not digesting well, and they're having these burping kind of episodes because the food isn't being broken down, and that's a lack of acid. So I think there is a little bit of a demonization of acid, and it comes from a little bit of a dental context as well, because you know we see acids as such a problem, but it plays a role. And acids, for instance, in the mouth protect against certain species. So lactobacillus species release acids that inhibit bacteria that cause tooth decay. So there's a role for acids. I think it's all in balance. And I think if we introduce the right species, they kind of control that for us.
Great, great. I think that's most of the questions I had. Is there anything else that you want our listeners to know about in terms of the health of our mouth and our teeth and our jaws?
It's just that, yeah, any sign that you see in the mouth is it's a signal from your body potentially that something is maybe going wrong. Bleeding gums, you know, I would really start take that as from a message from your digestive system that something's not quite right, and that you know, really try and use your mouth as a way to kind of hear what your body's feeling and experiencing.
So bleeding gums is not just a consequence of not flossing enough?
No, absolutely not. So bleeding gums really is an immune reaction. So I think it's the first signs of gut dysbiosis, because you've got that immune reaction into the mouth. I think it's probably the first sign of leaky gut. And so gum disease, I really think I'm writing an article at the moment on leaky mouth, and that the idea that gum disease really is a problem starting in the gut, and it's that loss of interface both in the gut and mouth between your immune system and bacteria.
So I think we kind of all have it wrong, because we all are thinking I'm flossing and brushing to get that bacteria off of my teeth, because that's what's creating all the problems.
Yeah, the main thing we need to be thinking is introducing the good ones, the supportive ones. That's the most important thing. You can floss and brush all you like. It's going to have a very, very small impact on the bacteria in your mouth anyway, because there's trillions there. You don't the introduction of nutrition and your environment stress, these are the bigger factors for your mouth.
So what are we really doing with brushing and flossing then?
Well, it's a superficial way to address our teeth. It's kind of a societal thing as well. You know, if you look at the photos from Weston A. Price, you'll see these big white smiles, and you know, they didn't brush their teeth. So, you know, it's something we think, you know, we've tried to kind of counterbalance the modern diet with brushing and flossing, but you know, it's a very superficial way to kind of address our teeth.
Oh, interesting. So if we were eating a natural diet devoid of processed foods and sugar and all the other crap, we probably wouldn't be a need to brush your teeth. The fiber and all the roughage in the food would actually...
Well, you still get plaque buildup, right? But there's no problem, because you've got a balance of species there. Yeah, it's not an issue. It's you know, you get plaques in the mouth, you get plaques in your gut, you know, in the villi of the digestive system. That's how bacteria live. We live with bacteria. Learning that we are, you know, symbiotic with these creatures really is, I think, the bigger message.
Great. So for listeners and viewers who want to get a hold of you or get a hold of your book, how should they get more information? And your book is available through Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and other places?
Yeah, so The Dental Diet is, they can grab it on Amazon and in store at Barnes & Noble. They can find me on my website, Dr. Stephen Lin, drstevenlin.com. And on social media at Dr. Stephen Lin.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Lin. It was a very interesting podcast. I appreciate you spending the time.
It's a pleasure, Ben. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Bye-bye.